إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, all praise and gratitude is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most gracious, the most merciful. We seek His help and forgiveness from the evil of our souls and from the sins that we have committed. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace and blessings on our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and all of his righteous followers till the day of judgment. And may Allah make us of those righteous followers. Ameen, ya Rabbal Alameen. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship except for Allah, and that he has no partners in his worship, and that the Prophet Muhammad is his final slave and his messenger. May Allah make us of his true slaves. Ameen. O you who believe, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he should be feared, and die not except in a state of submission, in a state of Islam. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord, the one who created you from a single person, and from him he created his wife, and from them both he created many men and women. And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through whom you demand your mutual rights. And do not cut the relationships of the wombs. Surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watches everything that you do. O you who believe, keep your duty to Allah and fear him, and always speak the truth. Indeed, the best of speech is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the Quran al-Kareem. And the best of guidance is the sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the worst of matters that are innovated in our acts of worship by people, and those are called bidah, and anything that's bidah is gone astray, and anything that's gone astray is in the hellfire. May Allah protect us from the hellfire. Ameen. My dear brothers and sisters, today's khutbah, with a lot of thoughts going through my mind, especially as I walked in and I was discussing issues with the youth and the struggles with the youth, and how many people are struggling with the calling of sin around us in our community. So the khutbah is supposed to be dedicated today, but hopefully it will have some practical tips as well and solutions, and some of my own personal experience with the youth. So the topic is not really discussed too many times, because a lot of times we talk about the forgiveness and the importance of asking for forgiveness, the importance of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but what exactly is sin? I haven't personally heard a khutbah dedicated towards the effects of sins and how dangerous a sin is. Because if the youth and all of us don't understand the effects of the sins, we can have remedies, we could have camps, we can have programs, but the solution will not be there until we understand that every one of us individually needs to understand the effect of sins in our personal lives, which no one else can help me but myself. Because at the end of the day, we have to make our personal decisions on the type of life we want to choose. We can provide solutions, but someone has to take this leap of faith and take the step forward. And as boring as it might seem, but you have to understand the opposite side, as nice and visually appealing it might seem, is the most destructive thing for you and for the generations to come. And so I wanted to dedicate at least the first part of khutbah, so everyone here is on the same page, to understand the effects of sins and how it affects you, not just from a religious point of view, but physically, emotionally, spiritually, and in many other ways, in your risk, in what you earn, in the barakah that you feel in your homes, and the marriage that you're going to have. Everything is connected to the type of lifestyle that you live. And no wonder why we have so many people who try to find solution in Islam, but they're not willing to give up their sins, and it just doesn't go anywhere. And then they blame Islam and people who practice Islam for not providing for that. And obviously, there's a lot to be done where we need to provide alternatives to sins, and that will be hopefully the second part of the khutbah. So first of all, I want to start off by reminding ourselves that we are not here on earth because we are being punished. We have to get that concept out of our heads, because we are here because Allah wanted us to be here no matter what. Even though that Adam alayhi salam was forgiven when he committed a sin in Jannah, But we are still here, not because we're paying for the price of that sin, because that sin was forgiven. So understand that you're not here, and when you go through hard times, that you're being punished. Understand that the whole life, the word that we should be using is that it's a test. If we understood that this life is a test, a lot of things will become a lot easier to understand why they happen. And even if they don't make sense to you, the test doesn't always make sense. But it's the outcome of it that makes sense. It's the outcome of it is what we're going after. And everyone here struggles hard for even the tests of this dunya. We've all written exams, and we understand that if you don't prepare well, then you pay for the consequences. But while you're preparing, you can complain all you want. But the fact of the matter is you are going and moving yourself towards a future outcome, which will be much lovely and much more appealing if you can put that effort early in your life. And so Adam alayhi salam, when he committed a sin, he said, and Hawa, قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَا مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. They said, our Lord, we have wronged ourselves. They accepted the mistake. They didn't say, well, you know, things are tough. We got tricked. I have my own reasons. They didn't do any of that. They immediately accepted that I made a mistake. We wronged ourselves. And if you do not forgive us, then have mercy upon us, because surely otherwise we will be among the losers. So this dua, even though was made in Jannah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted their forgiveness, but there was still consequences for those sins. So we are on earth, like I said, because that was going to happen no matter what, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels that we will be sent as Khalifa on earth, and our responsibility would be to propagate the message of Islam to people and to go through this as a testing period. But our real homes are in Jannah. May Allah make us of those who enter Jannah. Ameen. Now, Hasan al-Basri, this is to connect with us to understand that, yes, maybe you don't find a lot of things attractive, and maybe there's not a programs and not a lot of activities, but understand at the end of the day, the sins will have an effect in every aspect of your life. So Hasan al-Basri rahimullah, a great scholar of Islam, one person came up to him and they said that we're having problems with wealth. I'm having problem with money. So he said, stop sinning. Another individual came and he said that I'm having trouble having children. So he said, stop sinning. Another person came, he says, we're having drought and we have, you know, our crops are affected because there's no rain coming down. And he said, stop sinning. And so the students of Hasan al-Basri said, why did you give the same answer to everybody? You know, just stop sinning. Like, it's so easy to say that, right? Like, it sounds very simple, but literally that is the solution. If we can put an end to our sin, if we can work hard towards that, you will see the effects of that immediately in your life and the barakah of it. And so Hasan al-Basri told them, didn't you hear in the Quran when Nuh alayhi salam was complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about his people? What did he say about it? About their attitude. He said, as in Surah Nuh, it is mentioned, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالِ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَرْجُونَ لِلَّهِ وَقَارًا. And so Nuh alayhi salam said, ask forgiveness of your Lord. Indeed, he is a perpetual forgiver. Doesn't matter how big your sin is. Doesn't matter how many times you committed the sin. Just ask for forgiveness. It's as simple as that. Don't ever think that he's not there for you. He is not like a human being. Human beings have limits. Even your parents have a limit as to how much they can forgive a person. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no limit to his forgiveness. He is willing to forgive you. The point is, do not give up on it. And then he said, he will send, if you were to do that and ask for forgiveness and accept your mistakes, Allah will send rain from the sky upon it in continuing showers and give you increase in your wealth and your children, and he provide for you gardens and provide for you rivers. What is the matter with you that you do not attribute to Allah his appropriate grandeur? What is the matter with you that you don't see how great Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he can do that? And so subhanAllah, this was the proof Hasan al-Basri gave to his students that rain, the effects and rain, maybe we do not personally see the effects of and the need of rain because we have plenty of water around us, but we all know now from social media what water, how critical water is across the world, how many people do not have access to it. And if it stopped raining here, even if you go to drier areas like Dallas, Texas, there's places where they tell you do not turn on your sprinklers for grass and whatnot because they have lack of water. They have to preserve water. So rain, coming down of rain and your risk and having children, good righteous children, and your wealth is all connected to the type of life you're living. And whether it's a life of sins or a life of asking for forgiveness and making changes in your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then goes on to say in the Quran, ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Corruption has appeared throughout the earth. Yes, we see corruption, right? But did we ever make a connection of that to our personal individual decision on a daily basis and the sins that me and you commit? Because Allah said, and it has appeared on the land, and not just on the land, but also on the ocean. And we see now oceans are being polluted, global warming, glaciers, everything affected. And why? What is the reason? Because of because of what the hands of people have earned themselves, meaning their sins, and what we have earned ourselves is the reason for what we see around earth, the corruption, not just on land, but also on sea. And so he may let them taste part of the consequences that for what they have done, and perhaps they may return back to righteousness. So the corruption around the earth is an effect of our sins, and it is the it is one of the taste of Allah's punishment to make us understand that we have to change our ways so that he will bring us back to righteousness. May Allah make us of those. Ameen. Obviously, this khutbah is not about what is a sin and what is the difference between minor and major sin. A lot of us, you know, might have questions about that too, which you can talk to the local imams. But I'm literally just talking about a sin that you know for sure is a sin, and you continue to do that sin, this will have major effects on your life. And so this is mentioned by Ibn Qayyim, rahimullah. We actually have a full course dedicated to this at the end of the, once the khutbah is over, you can ask me, at the end of this month, literally a 30 to 40 hour course, understanding the concept of sin. Because another reason for that topic to be so important is it could be a way of giving dawah to the community around us. Well, one of I work at General Motors, and my own boss has attended multiple of these weekend courses dedicating 40 hours because they see Islamic knowledge to be authentic and is very attractive to them. The way it's presented is what matters. And so a lot of us think that we are only different from the Christians because we feel that basically they believe in Jesus as the Son of God, and for us, Jesus is not a Son of God, but he's a great messenger of Allah. But that's not it. In fact, sin, the concept of sin, and that's why I started my khutbah explaining that we're not here because we're being punished. Where the Christian concept of sin is that we're here because we're being punished for the sins of Adam and Eve, and that is why there has to be someone to come and sacrifice for us for our sins, because otherwise we're unforgivable. And so someone else has to come and sacrifice themselves for our sins. That's why it completely diverges away from the Islamic concept, because the concept of sin is very different in Christianity as compared to Islam. So understanding this concept is a great way of giving dawah as well. Ibn Qayyim rahimullah mentions, and hopefully we can cover this as much as we can in this khutbah, eight to ten major effects of sins. Whatever that sin is, you and yourself personally knows. A lot of Muslims, the problem is not that you know what is halal, well, you don't know the difference between halal and haram, but it's not understanding the criticality and importance of the decisions that you make. Maybe it seems a lot of fun, and maybe it feels like you're getting away with it, but the long-term effects are horrendous. And you can ask people who have lived their lives of sin, they come back and they cry and they ask Allah's forgiveness and they hope, they wish that they had those young days and they could have spent those days in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with the right company. So being deprived of knowledge, that's the first major effect of sin, is you will be deprived of knowledge. Islamic knowledge would not seem attractive to this person, because knowledge in Islam is not just information that you feed your brain. As the scholars tell us, good knowledge is like a light that Allah places on a person's heart. Imam Shafi'i rahimullah, he was selected by Imam Malik as one of his greatest students because of his amazing intellect, his memory, and his ability to understand concepts at a very young age. So Imam Malik told Imam Shafi'i, I think that Allah has caused a light in your heart, so do not extinguish that light because of your sins. Knowledge in Islam is not just information like it is taught in our schools here. Most of our schools today do not focus on the character of the individual. It's not about character, it's just about grades, about information, and how smart you are. But Islam is all about character development, about your manners. If that knowledge does not affect you to become a humble person and less arrogant and more respectful to your parents, what good is that knowledge? It's just information. And so when we feel that there is a Quran, for example, in our hearts, and we appreciate that type of knowledge, it will go away because of the sins that people commit. And a lot of people who memorize the Quran can attest to that, many others in the past. I think it was Imam Shafi as well, who complained to his teacher about his memory. and he had a photographic memory, and the only thing he had done was seen a part of the ankle of a woman. And today, you know, you obviously walk out and billboards and everything is calling us towards haram. So it is tough, my brothers and sisters. I'm not saying that it's not tough, but there are consequences. We have to really pressure, put ourselves, work hard to lower our gaze, everything that happens, put ourselves in companies where less and less of that is being promoted, eliminate things that cause us to watch these things, because if we don't, it will have detrimental effects. We might not think that is important, but it has effect. Every time you see something haram, it's leaving a mark on your heart. And if it's not something that we're willing to change, it's going to cause deep spiritual issues. The second thing is it deprives provision. As narrated by in Ibn Majah, an authentic hadith narrated by Muslim Imam Ahmed, Thoban radiallahu anhu said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a man is deprived of his provision because of the sins that he commits. So yes, there is a direct connection between that. The third reason is it creates an alienation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so you do not feel attracted. You don't feel attracted to come to the masjid, to come and sit through a lecture, to listen to the adhan, to listen to the Quran. And one of the other signs is maybe if you're in a car and people are playing music, you're really, you know, into it. And the moment they play the Quran, it actually bothers your ears. And you say, you know, can we just talk? Can you just turn that down for a second? That's a sign of the fact that our hearts have effects. They've been affected by sins and we haven't realized, we haven't cleansed it. And we're now suffering because there's an alienation between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What bigger deprivation than that? If we were to not just end the khutbah right now and just talk about the fact that you will not feel any love towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what could be worse than that for a Muslim? When you don't feel love towards your Lord, the one who created us, the only reason why we're here today, you know, giving up our work, giving up our other responsibilities, we're here only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you don't feel any love towards Him. What could be bigger deprivation than that? Number four is things become difficult for this person. Whichever matter he puts his hands into, maybe an entrepreneurship, some kind of business, he finds himself that nothing just works out. Every new thing he tries, there's some problems that come up. The sinners will find darkness on their hearts. There's also the fact that sins stop you from doing other good deeds. Because when you commit a sin, it will force you or motivate you to do other sins with it. One perfect example of that is the example of Ka'b ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu. He was someone who did not go to the battle of Tabuk, I believe. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had made sure that everyone should participate in this battle, he procrastinated. And slowly, as the story goes, subhanAllah, he started feeling bad about it. And it turned out that Tabuk never took place. And the Prophet ﷺ started returning back. And now he realizes too late that he waited too long. So now he's thinking, what could he say to the Prophet ﷺ possibly to make an excuse? And then he felt, this is something that even us maybe won't do in front of the Prophet ﷺ. But because he committed a sin, another sin came to his mind, which was to lie to the Prophet ﷺ that, you know, I'll maybe make up a lie when he comes. But when the Prophet ﷺ came, he said that I could not find a single, I just could not do it. I could not lie to the Prophet ﷺ. And all of those excuses got wiped out. And I had to tell the Prophet ﷺ the truth, that it was my fault. He accepted, and his story is mentioned in the Quran, and one of the greatest stories of forgiveness. Because he did not make excuses, and he accepted. But the point here is that even a great companion like Ka'b ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, in other circumstances, he wouldn't have ever thought about lying to the Prophet ﷺ, because he committed this sin, it motivated him to do something else that he would have never otherwise thought about. And so this is another thing about sins. When you commit one sin, it makes other sins more attractive that you would have not otherwise thought about. And then you just, the circle continues. And that is the seventh point. The sins, they breed other sins. Just like good deeds will breed other good deeds. If you'd make a dedication to come to the masjid one time a day, it will take some sacrifice, but once the masjid becomes attractive to you, other things will become not so attractive. And then you would want to do other activities that surround the masjid. And so the circle would continue. But if people don't make that change, it's the same way. A sin weakens a person's willingness and his willpower. When you find yourself waking up in the morning lethargically, and you're not willing to get up and pray Fajr, this could be directly affected because of sins. Not just Fajr, but in general, just going to work lazily, just not able to wake up properly in the morning, just having a lazy feeling all day, that's another effect of sins. Number nine is that he becomes desensitized to sins. And this, to me, and obviously through the hadith, is one of the most dangerous state to be in, where a person doesn't feel bad about committing sins anymore. And we hope and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from that condition. I'll end with this hadith in Sahih Muslim. All of my ummah will be fine except for those who commit sins openly. And that includes cases where Allah conceals a person's sins, but the following morning he exposes himself and he says to people, oh so and so, look at what I did. And shamelessly exposes himself while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was protecting him all throughout the night and not revealing his sins to others, but he openly revealed his sins to other people. May Allah protect us and help us understand the effects of sins. Because of lack of time, we're not able to go through a lot of the practical reasons, but I will end the first part of the khutbah. أَقُولِ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ وَلَكُمْ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. My dear brothers and sisters, I will end with just a quick couple of reminders as practical tips. As I said, that sinning is not something that is, obviously it is something that we need to work on, but committing a sin is not the problem, but not accepting that it's a sin and to not ask for forgiveness is the problem. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, all of the sons of Adam are sinners, and the best of those who commit sins are the ones who return back to Allah immediately, who ask for repentance. So may Allah make us of the tawwabin, the one who asks for repentance. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also help us motivate each other with activities and programs and anything that we can do to unite each other and provide alternatives to the sins that are out there. And for that matter, inshallah, after the khutbah, I'll be here to talk about the course if you need more information, which will discuss a lot of details of practical tips for our communities and providing alternatives for the sins and making good deeds something beautiful to the communities out there. May Allah make us of those. Ameen. Inna Allah wa malaikata yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban nar. ربنا افرغ علينا صبرا وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الابرار سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله